Intel just ate Nvidia's lunch for content creators. From outright cloning GeForce Experience, a DLSS competitor, to Adaptive Sync, to beating them to the punch with AV1 encoding, the new Arc Alchemist line of dedicated GPUs from Intel are absolutely wild. Intel had their announcement presentation today for their dedicated GPU hardware, which they're now calling Arc, shipping now in laptops with higher end chips and add-in cards teased for later this year. Let's touch on hardware, then we'll talk about gaming and wrap up with content creation. The hardware itself seems like a substantially impressive leap over Intel's previous integrated iGPU tech. The graphics chips, specifically now called XeHPG, feature new processing cores, a new encode and decode media engine, a new display output engine, and a new graphics pipeline. The XeHPG hardware is broken up into what Intel is calling the Render Slices, scalable up to 8 on the higher end cards. Render Slices are comprised of their Xe cores, which could just be seen as normal GPU cores on any GPU, plus dedicated hardware for thread sorting, geometry sample processing, as well as dedicated hardware ray tracing units, which supports DirectX ray tracing, or DXR, and Vulkan RT as well. These cores are optimized for all of the features of DirectX 12 Ultimate for gaming, which includes features like variable rate shading, ray tracing, of course, mesh shading, sampler feedback, and so on. This is kind of great to hear, as the original run of dedicated GPUs from Intel that we heard about were primarily for server workflows and not really gaming parts. There is a nearly complete focus on gaming in this product stack. AI processing for both workloads and gaming came up here, with each Xe core getting 16 1024-bit matrix engines, which are supposed to be optimized for AI, along with 192 kilobytes of shared level 1 cache or shared local memory on each core. The AI gets involved here specifically with gaming in the form of AI upscaling. Yes, Intel is releasing their own DLSS competitor, but instead of it being temporal AI upscaling like AMD's FSR, it's supposed to actually be leveraging AI hardware, as Nvidia's solution does as well. This is coming early summer, and they already have a list of games with the integration ready to go for the tech. Unfortunately, XeSS, as they're calling it, does need to be integrated on a per-game basis, which will slow down its adoption. But I do believe that this kind of tech is going to be a default expectation for gaming as time goes on, so it's great to know that, you know, Intel has solutions too. Hey, if you've been interested in picking up my merch, we have awesome desk mats, which I'm actually using right here, pins and stickers. It's 20% off today through April 6th, so go check it out. You also get a free trial to Nebula, my own streaming site where my videos are ad-free, higher quality, and there's often extended and extra version. I'm putting a lot of maker content up there soon. Super stoked for the one I'm editing for that. But go check out my merch. That's eposvox.gg/merch. 20% off through April 6th. Don't miss it. To output your games, Intel claims that they have output capabilities for the future in their new Xe display engine. But by default, at least, we're looking at HDMI 2.0B and DisplayPort 1.4A. There's a note in the slides that it's DisplayPort 2.0 ready, but nothing about HDMI 2.1. This doesn't sound very future-proof to me, especially when they're talking about 360 Hz at 1440p, 8K 60 and 4K 120 in HDR. I really don't get why they wouldn't have HDMI 2.1 ready to go at this point. Regardless, the chips can handle 4 display pipes at full res, which is very handy. To handle all of this, 3 types of display syncing are supported. There's Adaptive Sync, which is great, but then Intel also announced 2 of their own new sync modes, Speed Sync and Smooth Sync. Speed Sync sounds like what Nvidia Fast Sync is supposed to do, but doesn't always do, which is maintain low latency, zero tearing monitor sync without having to enable VSync. It just does a faster and better job of flipping frames over as they become available. Smooth Sync, on the other hand, apparently aims to hide screen tearing a bit by blurring and dithering the differences between 2 frames being displayed at the same time. In their sample screenshot, it literally just looks like they've applied a blur filter at the edges of the tear, which I'm not sure how they're doing that without added latency to literally apply effects, but the screenshot's also just a simulation, so we'll have to test more closely once we have hands-on with the hardware, because I'm a little suspicious about that one. Gaming is cool, but the new media engine is where my interest really lies. The new Intel Arc GPUs give us the world's first, at least publicly available, hardware encoders for AV1, the open source video encoder that I have been hyping up on this channel for years. AV1 enables vastly higher qualities at lower bit rates for video encoding, and once more widely adopted, will allow for higher resolution and higher frame rate streaming on sites like YouTube and Twitch, and allow for better looking lower bandwidth playback from websites like Netflix. YouTube is already covered in AV1 videos if you enable it in your playback preferences and have the hardware capable of decoding it, but we haven't had accessible encoders yet. This is exciting. I think the GPU can also encode VP9 as well, which is
also nice. The slide just says up to 8K 60 12-bit HDR decode and up to 8K 10-bit HDR encode. So we'll have to do some testing and see just how high the AV1 encoder can actually handle specifically and how the quality compares to the CPU encoders enabled in the recent OBS update and so on. So get subscribed so you don't miss it. AV1 is really the future and I'm stoked that we're finally getting hardware for it. Apparently FFmpeg, Handbrake, which just uses FFmpeg, XSplit, DaVinci Resolve, and Adobe Premiere Pro are all already updated to encode with AV1 on Intel Arc GPUs. So that is awesome as well. Premiere usually takes years to implement new encoders after all. Relating to encoding and general content creation workflows, Intel described their Deep Link technology. This allows the CPU, iGPU, and Arc DGPU to all work together to speed up workflows even more. The dream of multi-GPU encoding and video editing seems to be here with this new lineup, which is really surprising. Dynamic power share is specifically relevant to laptops, but allows the GPU to be pulled at 100 millisecond intervals to dynamically allocate power between the CPU and the GPU to keep both fed and working at their best, and this can even be slowed down when running on battery to optimize for battery life. Then there's HYPER ENCODE, and this is literally just splitting up video files into GOPs, or groups of pictures, and just having the DGPU and iGPU encoding alternating frames, if both the DGPU and iGPU have the same encoder relevant to the work, to encode much faster and bring it together in the end. For H.264 and HEVC, this will be a massive performance improvement that streamers and video editors everywhere would immediately be able to feel the difference for. For AV1, the iGPU won't have an AV1 encoder, so this won't get used. This can bring up to a 60% transcoding performance jump, which is massive, honestly. All those questions I get about multi-GPU setups for streaming or video editing are about to get an answer. This workflow applies similarly to compute workflows as well, with HYPER Compute. This uses a machine learning service to dynamically balance workloads between CPU, iGPU, and DGPU to make sure the right workloads are assigned to the right places. Specifically with this tech, Video Enhance AI from Topaz Labs, which I previously used showing how to upscale my old family VHS tapes with, was 2.5 times faster on the new Arc GPU than integrated graphics alone, and 2.9 times faster when leveraging both the Arc GPU and the integrated graphics, which is pretty neat. I use Video Enhance AI a lot, but not as much as I would like to due to speed, so I'm excited to see how this can help that workflow overall. Overall, with all of this technology, it is very laptop focused, which is neat, but I really hope a lot of this workload sharing can still work out nicely on desktop as well. Lastly, I wanted to mention Intel's new Arc Control app. There's no easy way to put this. It's just a straight up clone of Nvidia GeForce Experience. Perhaps better though, as it provides some updates that many of us wish GFE would have gotten by now. Arc Control is a one-stop shop app that allows you to manage and update drivers, tune and tweak performance, view hardware and gaming performance stats, manage and optimize your game settings, you know, everything GeForce Experience does, even with an in-game overlay. But it goes beyond that and integrates what would be, I guess, the Nvidia Broadcast app too. Arc Control has a Creator Studio feature, allowing you to stream or record your gameplay and create automatic highlights. This goes beyond what GeForce Experience can do for capture and streaming. It looks fairly basic, you know, despite being an upgraded GFE, but there does seem to be a sharp stream feature that they didn't mention. I can assume this is either just a sharpening filter or perhaps an AI upscale feature, along with, you know, they have AI webcam processing. So you've got background removal, background blurring, background replacement, along with auto framing. The only thing missing here from Nvidia Broadcasts would be the AI background noise removal for your microphone. And of course, they had to add a jab in with the Arc Control note that it does not require a login, which has been a big complaint about the GeForce Experience requirement. Again, the quality and performance of all these features remains to be seen. We'll have to, you know, get hands-on on the tech and actually test it out ourselves. And only the first lower-end laptops are releasing now. More on the actual add-in cards and more powerful laptops are coming later this year. But let's just say it's an exciting time for technology, especially in the gaming and streaming and content creation realms. Make sure you're ready to stream with this new tech by watching my streaming audio guide here or my lighting guide here. I'm EposVox, the Stream Professor, and remember, be kind, rewind.